exploring the bizarre. Your e-ticket ride into the world of the paranormal. Strap yourself in as we traverse the universe, exploring the unexplained. UFOs. Ghosts, lost worlds, cryptozoology, as well as other dimensions. It's time to take back the night. Now, your electrifying hosts of Exploring the Bizarre, Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz.
Oh my God. Tim, they were all around me and I'm stuck out here in this awful swamp. I'm up to my knees and in swamp water and muck, and oh my God, there's crickets and loons and a crocodile or two and a stench of something hideous coming from behind me. Oh, hey, wait a minute. Oh, wait a minute. It's my friends. It's Sasquatch, Bigfoot, Skunk Ape. Well, keep a distance there, buddy. The Russian Ape Lady Alma. And my God, what do you say? You're inviting me to a party? What party are we going to? It's whose birthday? We're celebrating whose birthday this week? John Keel's? Well, shit, yeah, I'll come along with you. Happy birthday, John. You can't join the party, I guess, for real, but you're welcome to be there with us in spirit. Happy birthday, John Keel, because without you, there would be a few less cryptids in the world. And, Tim, are you coming along with us?
Sure, I'll come along. I didn't realize it was Keel's birthday.
Oh, yeah, it's March 25th, and so you got to get in your swamp buggy and get on over here. I know it's quite a drive from Indiana, but you can make it. You know, just head on down through Texas and Louisiana, and you'll be here in God knows how long. And oh wait, I'm trying. Can you, hey Sasquatch? Can you keep that crocodile at a safe distance there? Anyway, Tim, it's good to be back on the air. I mean, I know I'm going to have to huff and puff in order to get to the party, but we'll get there. I can see some lights off in the distance. Oh, those are lights over the swamp. Oh, well, that must be a John Keel party then. Ah, so, Tim, how you been out there?
I'm doing great, man, but it doesn't sound like I don't think I'm doing quite as great as you are.
Oh, well, you don't know. It's all that southern moonshine. I wish I had me a big bottle of that now. That 200 proof kind, yeah. Then the show would go much quicker. I don't want the show to go quicker because I enjoy doing the show. And you know why? Because tonight we're discussing one of my favorite topics, Boggy Creek. I love that movie. Have you ever seen that, Tim, the original Boggy Creek?
Oh, yes, of course. Well, I mean, it came out in, what, 1972? And played in our small town movie theater.
As I understand it, that movie was made for less than $100,000.
That's right.
And it grossed several million, at least. And
at least.
Yeah, it's in the public domain because I know I make copies and every once in a while, send it out to somebody who's bought one of our cryptozoology books. And everybody seems to love it. And you know why? Because it's part fact, it's part documentary, but it also has an element of suspense to it. Very well made, very well made. And we got a filmmaker with us tonight who's also made a movie on Boggy Creek. But Tim, tell us about our guest. I'm sure the audiences are in suspense. And besides, I got to make my way here through with the skunk ape and that Russian ape lady, Alma. She's getting a little too feisty again, you know. But we'll get on with the program. Just tell the audience here who we've got with us tonight.
Sure. Just watch where you're stepping, Tim, and watch out for the water moccasins.
That was the crocodile's mouth.
Poor crocodile.
Ah, you bet.
Well, Tim, yeah, we're really fortunate tonight because we've got Lyle Blackburn and just one of my favorite writers and investigators in this, you know, the whole cryptid creatures type of a genre. And Lyle has written some absolutely fantastic books like the Beast of Boggy Creek, the Lizard Man, and he's also been in a number of different fascinating programs, Coast to Coast, and television shows on Discovery and Animal Planet. And I think that, you know, like a lot of us, he probably got his start as a kid watching The Legend of Boggy Creek. And I should also add that, you know, his most recent book is Beyond Boggy Creek, In Search of the Southern Sasquatch. Now, along with Lyle tonight, we also have Seth Breedlove. And Seth is a filmmaker. He's got his own production company called Small Town Monsters. Let's see. He's done a number of small short genre films, but his most recent is a full length production called The Boggy Creek Monster, which is now available on DVD and through streaming services such as Amazon Videos and I never pronounce that right. Vimeo on demand. I'm not sure that I said that right. So, Lyle, Seth, thank you for being with us tonight on Exploring the Bizarre. It's great to have you both with us.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
Well, you know, so I'm just getting to a little dry patch here in the swamp. Lyle, let's get down to business here. How did you get involved in Boggy Creek? But you're a cryptozoologist, and you've written a lot about the paranormal and what I would consider the paranormal, actually. How'd you get your foot all into this?
All muddy, so to speak.
How did I get
muddy? The waters, well, muddied the waters, yeah.
Yeah, I did start out fairly muddy, you know, at a young age, going with my father to the woods. He's an avid bow hunter, so I was, you know, exposed to the outdoors and sort of loved that. And as well, I had a fascination for both movie monsters and then a little bit later, you know, Bigfoot and cryptids like that as I started reading some of the early publications on Bigfoot and Loch Ness Monster and things. And then that was, like you guys, you know, had guessed, once I saw The Legend of Boggy Creek in a drive-in theater when I was really young, that sort of solidified it for me, because that sort of brought things closer to me. I'm from Texas, and Boggy Creek is near Falk, Arkansas, in the southwest portion of the state, which is about 3.5 hours from me. So once I saw that, I mean, I was full into it. It was something that just sort of stayed with me. And then later, as I became a writer, you know, and eventually thought, you know, I wanted to write a book, I thought, what's my favorite subject? The Legend of Boggy Creek. I want to, you know, investigate, find out what's true about that. And that's really what propelled me into, well, being on the show and other things.
Hey, well, tell us a little bit about The Legend of Boggy Creek, both the movie and the real legend. I'm sure there are probably a few people out there in radio land who are not who are too young, perhaps, to know about the this semi-documentary movie. And tell us a little about it. And also, why do you think that it captivated an audience? I mean, audiences the way it did, because certainly there were other films on Bigfoot. They were, you know, four-walled, where the producers would rent the theater and pop in a Bigfoot film and promote it in advertising and on TV and all of that. But why is it that Boggy Creek caught on the way it did? And tell us a little bit about Boggy Creek.
Well, it was a movie, like you said. It came out in 1972 and then later went into wider distribution in 73 when it was picked up, and it was made for $160,000 and went on to play in drive-ins, theaters, and later on TV, and made about $25 million. So in some ways, it's was the equivalent of modern-day films like Blair Witch Project that was, you know, kind of a cheap independent film that just worked right, got in the movie theater and did very well. The movie, you know, the tagline from the movie says a true story, and it is, in fact, based on real reports of people seeing a Sasquatch-like creature in southern Arkansas. There had been sightings that preceded the general public knowledge, but it wasn't until 1971 when a family was basically attacked by this creature that the story got out and began to appear in the newspapers. And that's when Charles B. Pierce, who directed the movie, was living in Texarkana and was reading the newspapers and thought, man, this is a great subject. And he ended up, you know, following through and making the movie. So, you know, it, at the core, it's something of a documentary, like you said, but it's a well-done movie in that it plays up the scares. It, you know, it creates a story out of it that's cohesive. And the reason it works so well is because it does seem so real. He didn't use actors. He did basically reenactments by the real people. You've got overdubs and a great narration that's got that southern accent. These were all, you know, authentic people that were in the movie, and it just made it, you know, so real. It seemed like, you know, the camera was really there when these people saw this creature, which was quite frightening in many cases. And that, you know, was later, of course, imitated by, you know, the Blair Witch Project and the sort of horror movie found footage trope that's used so much today. But at the time,
boy do I hate found footage. If I see something as a found footage tape, I won't even put it on. You know why? Because they always lose the tape at the end, so you never got any conclusion to anything. You know, I mean, it's a real hoax.
And to me, The Legend of Boggy Creek is done better because it doesn't pretend like the camera's there. It just gives that vibe, you know, that it is. And it, you know, of course, you know, shows like Monster Quest and later on, you know, where they do the reenactments, really all that can be traced back to The Legend of Boggy Creek. They did it so well and it was so successful. And of course, you know, it appears kind of cheesy today, you know, in some ways.
I still watch it once a year, at least. I watch it once a year.
I mean, it's still fantastic. I mean, historically, as for what it is, it's a great movie, and you know, it's, hey, we're still talking about it today, so it's quite something.
Well, I think, you know, there is something about its, you know, its low quality, the low quality way that it was made. I'm not sure if he actually, you know, like used 35 millimeter, if it was, you know, 16 and then blown up to 35, but it just has that immediate feel to it, almost like you're watching, you know, somebody's super 8 millimeter film of what actually happened. And, you know, and the fact that it really doesn't have any special effects, I think really adds to it as well.
Right. I mean, the fact that they had to do it cheaply really helped because they had to keep the creature obscured. I mean, they basically rented a gorilla costume from Hollywood, took off the chest piece, put a wig to make the hair longer and more scraggly, but it didn't look very good. So you really had to keep it, you know, shadowy, and that made it much more creepy than, you know, some cheesy monster full light.
What swamp creature does look, you know, well put together? I mean, they look pretty scraggly. That's the nature of the beast, I guess, pretty much. But what did the creature actually look like? Now, as opposed to most Bigfoot-type creatures that only had three toes, am I right about that?
Well, there's, you know, the movie documented an incident that occurred in June of 1971 in which there was a trackway that they found going across a bean field, and whatever walked across there appeared to have only three toes. And that kind of almost gave the Southern Sasquatch this reputation for having three toes. But there were other prints found at the time. There was some that it looked like it had four toes. And then as we move on and, you know, into more modern times, there's been five-toed tracks found. So the question remains whether, you know, if the creatures are real, do they all have three toes, or was it just an anomaly in that case or whatever? But you know, that was just something definitely that was made famous by the movie.
Yeah, it's something that you don't hear about too much anymore. You know, it seemed like, you know, in the 60s and early 70s, you know, the three towers, you know, there were a lot of tracks seemingly found with that. But I think as time went by, that's kind of gone to the wayside almost.
Yeah, somewhat. I mean, there are still some, you know, some that turn up. You know, if you're kind of in the Bigfoot world, immersed in it, then you see all sorts of stuff. And then, you know, occasionally I do see something of a three-toed track. But you're right; it's sort of gone to the, you know, pretty much five-toed tracks is what people find, and seems to be the majority of the cases.
Now the folks monster are actually, you know, like the Southern Sasquatch, as you call it. I mean, this is not something that just, you know, came out of the woods in the 60s and 70s. I mean, you actually ran across the newspaper articles that went back as far as the 19th century. Am I correct?
Oh yeah, yeah. In my newest book, Beyond Boggy Creek, I really kind of do a look at the entire Deep South, and you see stories in old newspapers that date back to the 1800s, a few scant stories maybe in journals from the 1700s even. But yeah, it's something that, you know, has been there, you know, conceivably all along, and you can find reports of wild men and, you know, hairy, feral type man-like creatures going back, you know, till as far as, you know, there was documentation.
And are the descriptions throughout the years similar?
Quite similar. I mean, there's one from 1851, for example, from Arkansas, that describes a giant, as they called it, a giant wild man that was described as being about 7 feet tall, standing upright, walked on two legs, yet it was covered in hair. And I mean, they didn't call it Bigfoot or the Falk Monster, but I mean, you know, you look at the description and you're like, well, you know, that would, you know, presumably been a Bigfoot.
And the, have the sightings continued, right up to, 2017? I mean, you know, the creature just didn't go, after it made its movie appearance, just go and disappear back from the woods again, waiting for its next Hollywood debut, has it?
It got himself a good agent, I suppose.
That's right, yeah.
yeah, certainly, they've continued. I mean, you know, the media kind of got tired of it after the 70s, and the movie sort of, you know, played out. So a lot of people's impression was that it all happened in the 70s, but, you know, in my research, you know, I've uncovered many sightings that continued from the 80s and 90s and on. And the latest one that I've, you know, researched by, you know, a sighting by a civilian, so to speak, occurred less than a year ago. And it's quite a solid, incredible sighting. So, yeah, they still continue. And my Beast of Boggy Creek book left off in about 2010. It documents up to there, and then it's, you know, just continued from there. So there's constant sightings.
Well, now has the description of the beast, I use that term, and I apologize to him, perhaps, if it is a him, has the descriptions altered any, or are we talking about multiple types of creatures, or are we talking about one distinct the sort? I know some of the in your book you describe other swamp creatures and other cryptids that have been seen throughout the southern part of the country. How does the Boggy creek creature differ, or is it as similar as everybody else, minus the toes, so to speak? Yeah,
it's similar. I mean, the reports are consistent, you know, throughout the years. Like in the Boggy Creek case, you know, the sightings now still report. You know, I mean, they're all somewhat vague, but it's certainly not just one creature, because I had a sighting in November of 2014 of a woman who saw it at 10 a.m. in the morning in full daylight and said it was probably 5 feet tall. So, you would conjecture there that it would be a juvenile. And then you've got some differences in hair color. You know, some people say it looks reddish, or some dark brown, some black. And that's kind of been consistent all along, that it appears not to be one single creature, because, you know, you have variations in hair color, yeah, height, and things like that. So
where are they hanging out? Is there one particular area, say, of several square miles where they seem to be observed the most? And why hasn't anybody caught up with one and really got a good photograph? Is there a photograph of the Boggy Creek monster? I don't know if I've ever actually seen one.
No, there's no photograph I've ever seen. I've heard a couple of, you know, mentions, or, you know, we got one on a game camera, we think, and we're going to try to find it, or my uncle got one, and I've never seen a photo. But there is a pattern of where the sightings occur, and Boggy Creek feeds into the Sulphur River, and the Sulphur River merges with the Red River, and the Red River is a major river basin here in the south. And so all that's kind of tied in with the bottom lands up there, what's called the Sulphur River bottoms. And within that area, most of the sightings have taken place. You know, you get a few that are closer to these town of Falk, which is a very small town. You do get those ones, but over the years, it seems like the sightings have occurred in more of the more rugged bottomland areas.
What is the closest town to Boggy Creek? Is there an actual town with that name?
Falk. No, there's no town. Yeah. It's Falk, Arkansas, which is, you know, it's often called the Falk Monster. That was the name newspapers used. The Boggy Creek Monster, that name kind of came after Pierce's movie, The Legend of Boggy Creek, and, you know, that kind of solidified the connection to Boggy Creek, which was something that the locals had already made, because Boggy Creek runs south of Falk, and a lot of the sightings, especially that happened in the late 60s and early 70s, occurred right there on Boggy Creek. So,
here comes our favorite little monster to tell us it's break time.
Now back to exploring the bizarre with two of the most electrifying researchers in the paranormal, your hosts, Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz.
And welcome back to Exploring the Bizarre. I'm Tim Swartz, and tonight we are talking about the Falk's Monster, the movie The Legend of Boggy Creek, and its influence that it had on a lot of present-day cryptozoologists. You know, they started out as kids, they saw this movie, and they were like, wow, this is great. And I was just, I was wondering, you know, Tim Beckley made a comment that there were probably other Bigfoot-type movies before The Legend of Boggy Creek, and I was just, you know, there was a Hammer film made about the Yeti, but as for Bigfoot type of movies before that, I can't think of any. So
well, you know who made films was Schick International, I believe the name of the company was, and they were actually owned by the Mormon Church.
Yeah,
and they made films like The Life of Jesus, and they made a movie or two about Bigfoot, and they would rent theaters, you know, and then put out sensationalistic advertising and posters and the whole bit, and pocket the money and go on into the next town.
I remember, you know, Crown International made some, you know, like a semi-documentary, you know, like Bigfoot or you know, like ancient astronaut types of movies. But I was thinking that they may have came after The Legend of Boggy Creek. Well, why don't we ask Seth Breedlow? He's been on the line, chomping at the bit, obviously, for us to ask him a few questions. So, Seth, let's bring you in. Welcome to Exploring the Bizarre.
Yeah, thanks for having me. No, you know, when you're talking about Bigfoot movies, I just got back from a Bigfoot film festival out in San Francisco, and the guy had actually kind of organized all these classic, quote-unquote
Sun classics. Yeah.
There was Toho actually had a movie called Half Human that I think is often credited as being like the first sort of Bigfoot movie.
I remember that one, yeah.
It's a pretty good one. And I mean, I was shocked at how many Bigfoot movies there are. And for the most part, they all revolve around someone going camping and then getting, you know, chased around the woods with a half naked woman by a Bigfoot. And, there definitely is a lot of Bigfoot cinema, but not a lot of quality Bigfoot cinema. And I consider The Legend of Boggy Creek to actually be a really high quality piece of filmmaking, even though it is an amateur movie in a lot of ways, and Pierce hadn't, you know, had a lot of experience with this kind of thing. I think some of the shots in the movie are gorgeous, and I think the storytelling is actually pretty solid, and I'm a big fan.
Well, now, when did you first run across it?
See, I'm a newbie. I came across mm-hmm. The Legend of Boggy Creek because of Lyle's book, The Beast of Boggy Creek. So because of reading his book, it kind of got me interested in the original movie. And then Lyle had approached me about doing something together with this story even before I had seen the movie. So I actually kind of experienced the movie after I was aware that I was going to be doing something that focused on it. But last year when we were kind of gearing up for post-production, I spent a ton of time just pouring through it and going back over it. I can remember taking naps on the couch while it played in the background just so I could kind of, you know, get my mind into that whole Boggy Creek realm that Lyle kind of dwells in. But it's yeah, I'm new to it.
Well then, okay. Now considering that, you know, you're a filmmaker using, you know, 21st century cameras and techniques, you take a look at this film, which was made you know, in the early 1970s by somebody who had really little experience in making films. You know, I mean, it could seem almost laughable, you know, looking at how he did it. Yet, if you're a serious filmmaker and you kind of look beyond some of the obviously, you know, amateurish techniques, there's really a lot to be said with the way he put that movie together.
Well, you know, this I would call it's an exploitation film. I mean, basically, it is. And you don't really see too many of those today. The art has changed. Would you say, Seth, that you know, in the old days, you'd have creatures coming out of the screen and running up and down the aisles. And there was a guy who used to be pretty famous for making that kind of film. And he even did a movie, I think, on venereal disease and had actresses dressed up as nurses running through the theater or something. I don't know. You know, it's like crazy stuff.
William Castle did that, you know, where he had all kinds of techniques like that, you know, people running out of the screens or little devices under your seats that would tickle your feet.
Well, now they have it and they charge you like $28 to attend a screening. It's called 4D.
Yeah.
See, Lyle knows probably more about this than I do, but to my reckoning, you know, what I think, it seems like Pierce was a very savvy sort of businessman, and at least had some eye for how to market a movie. And I mean, in a lot of ways, I think he was the godfather of indie cinema. We just got back from like a horror film festival that we did last weekend. And I was on a panel with like Lloyd Kaufman and a lot like indie, these guys that are considered indie B movie legends. And
was the Toxic Avenger there?
Toxic Avenger stood right off to the side of the stage the entire time, which was unnerving because I felt like he was kind of drilling holes in the side of my head standing there. But the question kept coming up, like, how do you get to the point where Lloyd Kaufman is at, which is kind of funny. But people kept asking, how do you get to this point, you know, where you're making movies like this for a living, and how do you jump into it? And one guy made a statement that you've got to make the best movies in the world today for them to be seen because of how much competition there is. And my counter to that was that, like, be like Charles Pierce, like, just pick up a camera and start making freaking movies, and people will discover them or they won't discover them. And either way, you're going to hone your craft and you're going to learn as you go. I mean, we're learning from movie to movie, you know, how to make movies. And I think that's what Pierce did. And I think he started at this place with The Legend of Boggy Creek. And, you know, by the time his career was over, I think he had learned a lot, and I think he'd become a pretty polished filmmaker. But again, like, I still see a lot of really quality moments in The Legend of Boggy Creek. And I like the fact that it's its own complete thing. It's kind of the forerunner for the found footage genre. And yeah, I consider him the godfather of indie film.
Now, there was one character in there, I mean, a real individual, who had more sightings. Recently he died, I understand, had more sightings of the Boggy Creek Monster than anyone else.
Are you talking about Smokey Crabtree?
Yes.
Yes, Smokey, you know, I knew Smokey well, and he passed away a little over a year ago, and Smokey never had a sighting of the creature himself.
Though he didn't.
He tried. His son had one of the pivotal sightings in around 1965, and many of his family members, the Crabtrees, did. But Smokey himself, he had never had a sighting. But he was in the movie and sort of became the spokesperson for, you know, the legend, and was the guy who kind of carried on the research and was the guy that, you know, prior to Seth and I, that was, you know, the go-to guy for the facts and the history about the case. But yeah, ironically, he never had a sighting.
Now, Seth, how did you get into filmmaking to begin with?
That's kind of a funny story, because originally this was what I had wanted to do when I was a kid. And at some point I had, kind of figured it was impossible to get into this. So I had gone the route of freelance newspaper reporting and other kind of meaningless jobs. And at some point during, I became interested in Bigfoot in like 2005, but in about 2012, I put together a proposal for a book about small town monsters. And I ended up meeting these two guys who wanted to work on a movie. And I was like, I got a great story. Let's do a short sort of YouTube documentary about the Minerva Monster. So we put together the Minerva Monster movie, which ended up being almost a feature length. It's 55 minutes. And that was how I got sort of started down the path of doing small town monsters. And we're working on a Mothman movie now. We start shooting a fifth movie in May. So we're moving quickly, but part of that is just learning, you know, as we go. I enlisted a lot of my friends that I grew up with. My best friend, Zach Palmisano, has been my director of photography in the last two movies. And Zach and I kind of met because of our love for film and wanting to make movies and stuff like that. So it's something I've always wanted to do, and it's something I've definitely got a big affinity for. And I'm mildly obsessed with classic cinema, with like Hitchcock and Hammer Horror and Ray Harryhausen and that kind of stuff. So that is more of an influence, I think, on me than anything sort of modern day. But I've always been into this stuff. And my mom got me hooked on Harryhausen when I was like 12 years old. So you could say I've been into monsters my whole life.
Oh, good for her. Yeah. Any fan of Ray Harryhausen is a friend of mine. So,
I mean, Seth and I see eye to eye, because that's all the stuff I love, and, you know, all that too. in fact, I met Harryhausen once, which was kind of at the top of my list for dudes that I thought I would never meet. So big fan. Yeah.
Oh, that's that. Now that had to have been a peak moment to actually have been able to meet Ray.
Yeah, it was super cool. He did a book signing, and you know, he was quite old. And you know, nowadays there's horror conventions, and I've seen, you know, Freddy Krueger, Robert Englund, you know, 50 times. It becomes like, hey, dude, or whatever. But with Harryhausen, it was like, you know, this is sort of a god. You know, he was like the upper echelon, and you know, just even meeting him, talking to him for a few minutes or whatever was just a highlight.
Seth, I'm curious, just real quick, what is the Minerva Monster?
That was our first movie, which was actually about the Minerva Bigfoot flap of 1978,
mm-hmm.
which was, it's kind of an underreported story, but I grew up in Bolivar, Ohio, only about 15 minutes from Minerva, so it was a story I was always aware of. Basically, in the summer of 1978, this one particular family kept encountering possibly a family of Bigfoots, but definitely one Bigfoot living on the hill behind their house. And it would constantly come to their house and kind of harass the family in a way. And the story blew up in the national media and kind of ballooned into the public eye. Internationally, it was covered by news crews from Germany and Japan. The local police investigated it. There was rumors that the National Guard investigated it. So it was one of the stories I was always familiar with, and it was something I wanted to do. So when we set out to make a story, a documentary about it, we didn't know how far we were going to get, hence the idea of kind of making it as a short film. But we ended up getting a member of the family who'd actually encountered the creature in our movie, which was bizarre because Howie had never spoken about it before, not in public. He'd never spoken about it publicly or on TV or anything. And in fact, right before we got him in our movie, he had been offered a certain sum of money by a major television show to be on, and he had turned them down, which is his modus operandi kind of leading up to that was to completely avoid any kind of, you know, televised appearances. So when we got him in the movie, we kind of knew we wanted to do something that was more of a feature and would kind of tell the whole story and kind of show people that the Minerva Monsters, an ongoing case. It didn't end in 1978. And just like the Boggy Creek story, it's still going on today. And I get weekly emails from people, you know, who've claimed to have encounters with the creature. And one of the weirdest, actually, I can tell you guys about this because this is pretty cool. We just had an email come to us recently from someone who claims that they found a picture, a photo of the Minerva Monster at a garage sale outside of Minerva. Someone sold them the photo. They were walking to the car with a tackle box that had the photo in it. They bought the tackle box. The tackle box apparently had the photo in it. They were walking to the car with this tackle box, and the person chased them down and insisted on getting the tackle box back. So I thought that was a great story. But hopefully at some point we can track that photo down.
Oh, it sounds like a lot of lost UFO photos or you know, pieces of the Roswell UFO crash or something like that.
Right, right.
Well, I was thinking now, and this may be another Ohio case that took place, you know, close to the same time. But wasn't there also UFO activity associated with the Minerva sightings?
There was a lot of UFO activity connected with it. And in fact, the police sheriff that investigated the Minerva Monster case, it also investigated a UFO landing at the house across the street from the Cain's house within 2 weeks of the initial Minerva Monster report.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, I had an investigation, a trip many, many years ago, and I couldn't tell you the date, but it would have been in the mid-1970s, I was doing some work for a major magazine, and one of the editors lived out in Ohio. And I had happened to see a little item, maybe a two-inch news blurb in the New York Post here about a UFO that supposedly landed in a cornfield behind a farmer's house in Athens, Ohio. So I figured, well, I'm going to be, in Ohio, so let me check it out. I mean, a good UFO landing, you don't come across every day of the week. Well, I was kind of disappointed because I figured, oh, a cornfield, we're talking about something out like a Field of Dreams or something like that. No, man, this guy had a little corn patch behind his house. You know, I don't know, it wasn't very, very large. And I said, well, where did the object land? And the guy said, well, he didn't see it himself, but his grandson had. And he said, it's in the middle of the cornfield. And I said, well, how do you know? And he said, well, we went back there. You know, he saw this light or something from his bedroom window and went back there. And apparently the object had left some sort of indention in the ground and had matted down the corn. And I said, well, that's interesting, but there was really no proof, and it was probably a month or so after the actual incident took place. But since I was out there anyway, I figured, well, let me go and see if there are any additional witnesses. So I stalked the neighborhood, banged on a few doors, pretty rural area, to say the least. And I found a couple of people who, one woman said, yeah, you know, I saw some large cigar-shaped object over the hill, mountain over there or something like that. And then one woman said, I don't know about UFOs, but Bigfoot is around. And I said, Bigfoot is around? She said, yeah, he hangs out around my air conditioner in the back of the house, and we could hear him, like, you know, making some sound and pounding on the air conditioner and maybe washing his hands or whatever you do with an air conditioner that's dripping water or something. And she said, you know, I even found some, like, impressions in the ground where the thing had stood, and it must have weighed quite a bit because, the footprints were sunk into the soil and all. And I walked back there, I didn't see anything, you know, because it's just kind of like gravel and a little bit of mud and stuff like that. But that was my first thought. I had known Ivan T. Sanderson, but we had spoken more about UFOs and the Philadelphia Experiment than Bigfoot. But I had seen, you know, the Paris cast and stuff. Like that, but my main thing, of course, had been lights in the sky and landings and little men from Mars and little. We had little hairy creatures as opposed to tall hairy creatures in those days. But I was impressed by the fact that when I strolled around this neighborhood on foot, that there seemed to be a combination there of UFOs and Bigfoot. And I know that a lot of Bigfoot researchers hate to have somebody bring up the fact that these things may be paranormal in nature and not necessarily physical flesh and blood, ape type men. What's your take on that, Seth? I mean, do you see any paranormal elements to this?
Well, I'm a big fan of good stories. So anything that takes my fancy, I'm a fan of. Like my personal opinion, just based on the evidence I've seen. And again, I think Lyle and I kind of see the same way on this. I personally think it's some sort of ape, lost primate that we haven't managed to discover yet. That's my personal opinion. But there's definitely an overwhelming number of sightings that do include, UFOs and stuff. The thing about Ohio is you can't throw a rock without finding someone who's seen a UFO. Yeah. I mean, you're talking about Athens. Athens is included heavily in the Mothman story that we're working on right now because of the fact that Mary Heyer was.
I met her once. Sure, of course.
She was based in Athens, and there's UFO and Bigfoot reports from that whole area. Gallup Police, Ohio, which obviously is home to a large number of Mothman sightings, is also where the first recorded Bigfoot sighting in Ohio took place, which was back in the late 80s. I want to say 1800s. 1883, something like that. There was a wealthy man and his daughter who claimed to have been leapt upon by a large ape out of a tree. And that was down in Gallup Police, Ohio. So there's definitely a lot of times where you do find correlation between the reports. And I get where people might want to kind of carry their line of thinking in that direction. Personally, I think we're looking at an ape. if they exist.
Why haven't we gotten some physical evidence? We haven't captured one. We haven't shot one. Thank goodness. Hair samples and whatever else seem to be rather skimpy. You would think by this time that the Bigfoot would leave something behind.
Poo, for instance. Yeah.
Yeah. Poo. Yeah.
Yeah.
No. Scat, whatever you want to call it. Bigfoot scat. Yeah.
I think the scientific word is poo. But yeah, I
the scientific word. What?
I can give you all the standard Bigfoot person responses to that, but I'm still trying to figure this whole thing out for myself, you know, so I have the same questions you do. Why don't we have a photo? Why don't we have a body? Why don't, you know, what I'm basing my opinion of them being an ape on is the fact that the multitude of reported sightings involve ape-like behavior rather than, you know, there are a large number of bizarre accounts, but I'm not even sure the two are connected sometimes. Now, personally, you know, I totally believe they could bury their dead if that's a thing. And as far as taking a photo, man, I don't know. I want to get a photo of one so I know if they exist for myself.
Now, are some people actually claim that they communicate with a Bigfoot? And I've even heard stories where Bigfoot has set up, some kind of habitation in the back of their yard.
Sure.
There was a lady in Kentucky who made those claims.
I mean, that's not far off from what happened with the Caton family in Minerva. Their story, in a lot of ways, the Minerva monster story, in a lot of ways, is the first, not the first, but it really reminds you of like a habituation story, because it's this one family. The creature keeps coming back. There are some violent encounters with it, but more than anything, the family thought that the creature seemed to be connected to their mother, the mom that lived there, who was very ill at the time. So,
All right, we're going to have to interrupt you here because we're at our top of the hour break. So when we come back, we'll continue our conversation about Bigfoot and the Boggy Creek Monster. Stay tuned for
and
more.
I promise I won't poo-poo the subject.
Oh, thanks, Tim. Appreciate that. We'll be right back.
Exploring the bizarre. Your e-ticket ride into the world of the paranormal. Strap yourself in as we traverse the universe, exploring the unexplained. UFOs. Ghosts. Lost worlds. Cryptozoology. As well as other dimensions. It's time to take back the night. Now, your electrifying hosts of Exploring the Bizarre, Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz.
Welcome back to the second hour of Exploring the Bizarre. Tonight we're talking to Lyle Blackburn and Seth Breedlove about Sasquatch, Bigfoot, the legend of Boggy Creek, and other weird cryptids that go howl in the night. And Lyle, Tim, and Seth were discussing the whole paranormal aspect on on Bigfoot. And I want to hear your take on that. You've done a lot of investigation, not only on, Bigfoot, but, like the lizard man and some of these other bizarre creatures. I mean, do you think that we're dealing entirely with physical creatures that, we just haven't discovered and categorized yet? Or do you think that there could be, some other aspect to these sightings?
Well, yeah, certainly a complicated question to sort out. I mean, I think as far as Bigfoot, I just sort of take the base theory that they're some sort of flesh and blood primate creature. But as you start working into lizard men, moth men, these other things, those cases definitely stretch the bounds of biological limits. We can conjecture that there is, some sort of a primate, but when you start talking about upright reptilian humanoid creatures, it's harder to explain, what could account for those. And, the sightings are fewer and
farther between, and cases like Mothman, where you have it intermixed with a lot of other phenomenon going on, UFOs and all that. And, you know, I certainly can't deny that there are some, you know, UFO sightings that correlate with Bigfoot sightings. You know, our colleagues like Stan Gordon have had some really significant cases where you see that. But for me and most of my Bigfoot research, you know, I don't find, you know, I never get any sort of flaps of UFOs and then a bunch of Bigfoot sightings. It's just simply Bigfoot sightings in swamps in a place where a creature such as that would live. And even with the Lizard Man case, you know, people are like, well, you know, you can go off in those theories about reptilians that are infiltrating our government and all that, and UFOs. But even in that case, which most of that occurred in the late 80s in Bishopville, South Carolina, you know, there just wasn't a lot of UFO sightings that corresponded with that. It was simply people reporting seeing what they called the Lizard Man, which doesn't mean it was necessarily even lizard-like. It just, it was a local,
Tell us about Lizard Man. Now, did he attack a teenager in a car or something?
Yeah, that's kind of one of the most, you know, dramatic and well-known incidents. But basically, this started in the summer of 1988, and Bishopville is a very small town, again, in South Carolina. It's located near a swamp-type area, wilderness, and this kid had a flat tire in this area near Skateboard Swamp late one evening coming home from work, and he said as he finished changing up the tire and was getting ready to leave, he saw something coming at him in the moonlight, and as it approached, you know, first he thought it was a person, which was scary enough, I mean, right then and there, but then he could see it well enough to say that it didn't appear to be a person. It had the appearance of sort of a greenish or brownish scaly type skin, had three fingers with, you know, long fingernails, and he jumped in the car, and this thing tried to get in the car, and then as he took off, it literally jumped on the roof of the car and was clawing at him, and he swerved and got away. But he wouldn't even have told that story except for there were some other incidents that the sheriff's office were investigating prior to that had made it in the newspaper. And that's when somebody had told the journalist that, well, maybe it's the Lizard Man. There's been some sightings, but up until that, no one had documented any sightings. So when that appeared in the newspaper, then the father of this kid, who believed very much what he had told him, decided to take him down to the sheriff's office, and he told the sheriff that story. And even to this day, the sheriff said, you know, something happened to that kid. He didn't make it up. I mean, I don't know what he saw, but, you know, something dramatic happened to the kid out there in that swamp. And then the police got involved in the case, you know, just one of those fascinating sort of flaps where there's this really strange creature and all kinds of weird incidents and sightings. And then it unlike the Boggy Creek case, the sightings went up till, you know, several years and then just sort of stopped. So, you know, that's harder to explain, but, you know, certainly I think that people in this research, as you go on, you start thinking, well, how do we explain the fact that we don't have the photo? We don't have, you know, there is evidence, there is footprints, there are hair samples that can't be identified, but certainly I think, you know, a lot of theories get thrown on the table just to try to explain what the hell's going on, you know, and that's where all these other things come in. So I don't have an answer for those. I just do the research and document the stories, you know.
Well, now your book here, Beyond the Boggy Creek, which I'm holding in my hand, it's got a really great cover on it, and In Search of the Southern Sasquatch, leads us to believe that there's a lot going on down in Dixie, as they say. So how many type of creatures, the Sasquatch type beings, are wandering down in your neck of the woods, and where's the most concentration of sightings? You know, I know, of course, about the skunk ape of the Everglades. In fact, back in 1975, I wrote an article for Saga magazine. I did some research on that, and there were even then a whopping number of witnesses, some of them pretty credible, including a university professor and all, who were staking out the skunk creature in the Everglades there. How many southern Sasquatch are there, and what are some of the better known incidences, I guess?
Well, there certainly seems to be a number of these creatures. I don't know whether, we have how much variation there are. People say, well, do you think they're Bigfoot? Well, certainly they're, related. I don't think there's so many different species, but, they're creatures who, if they had traveled from the Pacific Northwest across North America and sort of settled into these small niches, they're going to adapt to the environment. So you have what, I call sort of the mountain monsters. You got sort of the ones that live in the higher elevations, and there are some mountainous areas in the south. And then you've got all these swamplands and bottomlands, Everglades. You've got a lot of those, and those are where you get the skunk ape type sightings. And a lot of times the creatures can be described as a little more ape like. They walk on, even seen walking on all fours at times. And so there's a wide distribution. And I think some of the concentrated areas would be southeast Oklahoma. Believe it or not, that is right up there at the top of the list. The Ouachita Mountains that span Oklahoma to Arkansas. Obviously, the bottomlands in southern Arkansas, East Texas, parts of Louisiana, and then there's distributions throughout Mississippi and the Carolinas and Alabama, and then Florida just has an amazing number of sightings. I mean, it's
well, really everybody goes to Florida, right?
Well, maybe there's more tourists with binoculars and cameras looking around, but yeah, I mean, it's certainly something that, for me, and one reason I kind of wrote that book is because, the legend of Boggy Creek is, arguably the most famous Southern Sasquatch case. But in my files and readings and research and interviews with witnesses, man, there's just a ton of those cool cases that stand out of cases where, aggressive attacks on people. There's one from Mississippi, which a hunter is literally attacked. There's one from North Texas, where a woman, some of these creatures allegedly tried to pull her out of a truck that had been stuck in the mud. And, just those cool things that have that total legend of Boggy Creek vibe about them. So it was cool to just sort of offer up all the history and stories throughout the whole South to show that, it's not just an isolated incident. Presumably these creatures, dug into the swamps and the mountains all over.
Lyle, what's your impression of the Ketchum DNA project? I mean, they had, really a lot of, it seemed to me, good investigators submitting DNA samples. Yet once some of the results were publicized, just all hell seemed to break loose.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not a trained scientist, so I mean, I can't comment necessarily on the techniques used and so forth. I can only refer to the reviews that have been done by the scant number of scientists that have looked at it. The problem I have with that whole thing is the protocol, the scientific protocol, the methods of peer review, all those sort of things were not followed very well in that case, if at all. It was published in a journal that nobody had ever heard of, on a website that they created themselves. All that reeks of just foolery. And if we want to elevate Sasquatch research to another level, it's got to follow the same scientific protocols as any other thing that we want to prove. Whether it's a bird or whatever, it needs to follow that. And it did not. And then some of the conclusions were, you know, outlandish with, you know, angel DNA and all this other stuff. It's like, you know, no one can sort the truth. Now, there were the thing stuff that was submitted, the, you know, purported pieces of evidence were coming from even people I've met or know. And in some cases, you know, they believe this to be good, solid stuff. So I think they were getting good stuff. It's just that I have no idea what scientific methods were used. And it just turned into a case of nobody could figure out if it was good or not, you know. Mm-hmm. So,
well, and how difficult, you know, how difficult is it going to be, though, to get, you know, any legitimate laboratory or scientist to actually risk their career to examine this stuff in the first place?
Well, certainly true, but there are some that will. And, you know, I've got connections with, you know, a girl that has a degree in forensics and you know, has connections to where I could get one of these samples run. I would just have to have a sample. And then I can tell you, if it came to me, it would just be run. And if it's good, it's good. If it's not, it's not. In the story, all this bizarre publishing and the way it's done, you know, that just, that again, tends to make, you know, other scientists, you know, throw out the Bigfoot with the bathwater. But, you know, there are a select number of individuals, and these tests could be run. It just needs to get in the right hands. You know, it just depends on who they're giving the samples to.
Now, with your own investigations, Lyle, have you had any personal experiences yourself? Seen anything, or has it been, you know, with you or with similar to me a lot of times, you know, oh, damn, I just missed it types of situations?
Yeah, well, yeah, I've never had a sighting that I would, you know, say is one of these creatures, unfortunately. I've been, like I said, I mean, as far back as I could walk, I was, you know, hunting with my father, and have been hunting and camping in the places where Bigfoot were, even before I knew Bigfoot sightings even existed in, say, Texas. You know, there's been some things that have happened. There's been some, an incident where there was a howl that it was occurring, and then it, whatever it was, had followed us along the Bayou Channel. I was there with one of the guys I often go out with, doing research, and he, you know, he's been a trapper in Mississippi, spent many years. Neither one of us could identify the animal that made the sound. It was extremely spooky. And, you know, I say, well, it could have been. And we've, you know, found what could be a partial footprint in the area of Falk. And even a weird incident that I talk about in Beyond Boggy Creek that occurred when I was in the Ocala National Forest in Florida. So, yeah, it's one of those where I was either just really darn close or, you know, I'm not lucky. I don't know. I've even been in the field with other researchers who seem to have a knack for going out every time and seeing them. But when I go with them, you know, which I rarely do, but occasionally I will take them up on they're pointing at something 30 yards away in broad daylight, telling me it's a Bigfoot. And I just go right for it, you know, and there's nothing there. So, either I'm blind or
yes, somebody's pussyfooting around, I would say. I don't know.
Mm.
I keep at it. I love the outdoors. So that's one of the things. It's not all about, I'd love to see one and stuff, but I just love getting in the outdoors. I love, you know, the stories and the possibilities. So it's, you know, it's not like I've been lost or wasted time. It's all been, you know, enjoyable no matter what happens. And if I do have a sighting, well, that's going to be the, you know, the cherry on top of the cupcake.
Well, you know, if you ever got any video footage or something, they'd say, oh yeah, you were making it up, you know. And speaking of video footage, Seth, How do you determine what to make your next movie? I mean, obviously you're making a career out of this.
Mm-hmm. The first three movies were kind of initially thought of as part of the book proposal. Maybe not so much Boggy Creek, but I had talked to Lyle so early in the game during making Minerva Monster that was always on the plate. So it was the initial proposal that I sent out to publishers had Minerva Monster, The Beast of Whitehall, which ended up being our second movie.
We had a fellow on who's written about Whitehall, the incident up there. Paul, I think his name is. Yeah, yeah.
Bartholomew?
Bartholomew. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, he's in our film, so he's a cool guy. But yeah, it comes down to the people more so than the monster or like the crazy, you know, encounter story. I'm more fascinated by the people and how these stories affected them. And I mean, it's always been what drives our movies. We don't do crazy recreations in our films, and we don't really kind of over dramatize the story. We're mostly trying to document what happened to these people and the effect it had on them and their lives. And I think that's really been driven home for me with two movies. One was Beast of Whitehall, but this Mothman movie is really like as I'm putting it together and getting it done, it's such a personal kind of story, which is interesting because it's also such a massive story even compared to our other movies. Mm-hmm. There's so many sightings and so many encounters of so many different things, but at the end of the day it's all about these people in West Virginia having these encounters and how it affected them and how these things impacted their lives in some major way. And that's what draws me. I don't know that there's a story or if I'd be able to do a movie that was just like, hey, here's a really cool encounter story. That's it. You know, we don't, the person's boring as can be. It had no impact on their lives.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it's a really great story. I probably wouldn't care.
What did you think of the Mothman Prophecies movie with Richard Gere?
Well, see, I knew nothing about Mothman or Mothman Prophecies, the book, before that movie came out, and I saw that movie opening weekend with two of the guys that are now helping me make the movie, and we loved that movie. So I've seen that movie probably.
Yeah, I went. I went with Keel to see it when opening night. So I always liked it. I never. I don't think it ever really got too as far as reviews go. Not that reviews really matter, but. I know the theater was packed, and it did relatively well for what the budget that they spent on it. And of course, it had the blessing of the Dalai Lama. But the thing was too, I think why it worked is because it had been promoted as being based on real testimonies. And even though, of course, it's a Hollywood-driven movie, but still compared to most of the other films that come out and says it's based on, some real story, and it's a total lie. Mm-hmm. I mean, you see a lot of these ghost stories. This is a total lie. The event never happened, only in the mind of the script writer, where the Mothman Prophecies had received, quite a bit of publicity, and it seemed to work. And, of course, the movie is still shown on TV, and I still watch it. I don't watch it as much as the Boggy Creek film, but I do. I don't turn it off if it's going to be on.
I can tell you as someone who's trying to condense that entire 13-month span of time from the Scarberry Mallet sightings, up to the collapse of the Silver Bridge. It's so much story. I don't know. In my opinion, they probably did all that they could have with.
Yeah.
With that story in a fictional movie, the only thing I wish they had left the same was the time period. I wish it was a period set, 1966, 67 movie. But I'm a big fan of that movie.
Yeah. Well, of course, I knew Woody Derenberger that plays kind of a minor role in that whole kind of flap. And Indrid Cold somehow, or the voice of Indrid Cold, showed up in Mothman Prophecies, but he didn't have anything to do. He was a spaceman. that, you know, Woody Derenberger had some sort of communications with it. That's a bizarre story, too. You know, the that case, it started out, I feel, with Woody being rather sincere about it. And then, of course, it kind of lapsed into your typical contactee story where he was off to Lanulos. And,
Yeah. 40 days he was gone, wasn't it, at one point? I mean, yeah. And then he ended up marrying another contactee.
Yeah, yeah. Well, they switched to families or something like that, you know.
I'm telling you, I'm neck deep in this story right now. It's like it's what I'm living and breathing. So I'm you know, consuming as much knowledge about it. But you know something about that Woodrow Derenberger story that I just found out in the last couple days.
Seth, I'm going to have to interrupt you here. Let's not get too deep into that.
No.
We'll pick this up when we come back. But I know we've got just a few seconds before we have.
I want to ask about the. A creature known as the Hide Behind. I don't know if anybody's heard of that.
No.
Well, we'll find out if we come back on Exploring the Bizarre.
Tweet your comments anytime to KCOR Radio or simply use hashtag KCOR. Even better. Jump in the live chat room and share your thoughts with the show at kcorradio.com. Now back to Exploring the Bizarre with two of the most electrifying researchers in the paranormal, your hosts, Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz.
You know, it's really hard to jump in the chat room when you're knee-deep in mud and when you got these high boots on. I mean, it's just a difficult thing to do. And, you know, I can see the lights off in the distance and I can hear the party noises. So we've got to, you know, head towards our destination. And so we're down to the last segment of the show. Now, I do want to bring in a little note here. This morning, I got an email from our associate, Peter Bernard, who is the administrator of our YouTube channel, Mr. UFO's Secret Files, and he has his own YouTube channel, probably several, but his best known is Scary Stories. In fact, he had a story up there the last week or so that's getting an incredible amount of hits. Donald Trump stole my yard sign. So that's a campaign sign or something. I don't know. I don't know why Bigfoot would want to do that. But
I thought it was Donald Trump stole my lunch.
Well, anyway, he told me about this creature. It's called the Hide Behind. I don't know if anybody's heard of it. I was unfamiliar with it, but I did a little bit of research, and surely enough, there is such a creature. At first, I thought he was, yanking my chain, but it turns out, no, it isn't. Anyway, the Hide Behind is a nocturnal, fearsome critter from American folklore that preys upon humans that wander in the woods and was credited for the disappearance of early loggers when they failed to return to camp. Now, supposedly, the creature Hide Behind got its name because it's so thin that it can actually hide behind the trunk of a tree and not be seen. And like I say, apparently some of the lair of the creature has been found on several occasions. The creature has a severe aversion to alcohol, which is considered a sufficient repellent. So he's not a drinking, he's a teetotaler of a beast, I guess. And tales of the Hide Behind may have helped explain strange noises in the forest at night. Early accounts describe Hide Behinds as large, powerful animals, despite the fact that no one has been able to see them. Anybody heard of the Hide Behind?
I have seen that and, you know, looked into it a little bit, and seems like one of those regional type names, you know, like the skunk ape and so forth. Yeah. But it's definitely described as something a little more different than Bigfoot.
Yeah.
But and obviously, very, you know, you're not gonna, I don't have any eyewitnesses that say they saw one last week or anything like that. So it's seems more rooted in folklore, I think.
Well, you know, maybe Hyde Behind is responsible for some of these mysterious disappearances that have been written up in David Pilates' books on 411 about missing people. I don't know. That's a theory. I haven't heard that mentioned on any of the interviews. And I figured, well, heck, man, here's a creature, a cryptid that I haven't heard of. And apparently the Hyde Behind is still out there hiding behind something or other at this point. Now, Tim, didn't you investigate a series of a creature sighting, historical creature sightings from Indiana?
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, I was getting ready to say that, you know, the description that you had of the Hyde Behind sounds an awful lot like some of the stories that my more elderly relatives used to tell us, except that they called them boogers. And but the descriptions are pretty much the same, you know, thin, they could hide behind trees, and they would never approach you from the front. They would always, you'd turn your back, and that's when the boogers would get you. But they were always, you know, situated out in the deep, dark woods. And, it may have just been, you know, stories naturally to keep, you know, make sure the kids didn't go out into the woods, but sounds very similar to the Hyde Behinds. But to ask your question, you know, there was a series of sightings in a town in Indiana called A Rising Sun that involved a Bigfoot type of creature, except this one seemed to tend more along the paranormal aspects, because it would I know at one point it got into a chicken coop, and when the owners ran out to see what the ruckus was going on, this thing, you know, was in the doorway, and this, you know, this was a, you know, a pretty good sized chicken coop. I mean, it, you know, you could walk into it, and it was so tall that its shoulders reached the top of the door, and they couldn't see its head because the head was then, you know, was inside of the chicken coop. Well, the owner blasted at it with a shotgun, but this thing disappeared in a flash of light and then reappeared on the other side of the property, and just right at the edge of the tree line. And there were a number of sightings by this one family, and then, you know, some of the families that lived nearby of this creature that bedeviled them all for, you know, a couple of weeks before, you know, and like a lot of these cases, it just mysteriously disappeared.
I was just picked up your book here. What are the road walkers, Lyle?
Well, that was a name I gave that section, you know, to give it an enticing name. It's not necessarily a traditional name for anything, but there's a lot of sightings where, you know, they were seen on roadways. I think in that section there was a sighting by some guys,
linesmen, yeah,
like, yeah, linesmen, yeah, the yeah. linemen out there, that like three of them were on that call, and you know, a couple of them had a really good sighting right along the road there in the Ouachitas or northern Arkansas. So, yeah, some really just fascinating sightings, you know.
And now, some of the skunk apes down in Florida, I remember, they were albino. Different hair color for the different creatures?
Yeah, you do. You do see reports of, you know, hairy Bigfoot-type creatures with white hair. There's quite a famous case called the Lakeworth Monster. Occurred in 1969 here in Texas, very close to me, and would have sort of been my hometown monster, but it was, I wasn't aware. I was too young for that, but... And then as I kind of looked into that case, if you look kind of along the Trinity River, which is a river that runs through the lake, you can find back in like 1938, maybe 40 miles away, there's another older sighting in which somebody had reported a creature with white hair. So you do, you know, do see those white-haired ones, and, you know, perhaps not coincidentally, you know, there's no way that lake, the people who reported the lake with monster would have known that there was a Bigfoot sighting some years earlier, you know, in which some coon hunters reported seeing a white-haired creature. So it's really cool when you kind of get that bird's eye view of the research and look at the history, you start seeing these things that are like, wow, it's either a, just a weird coincidence, or, you know, there was a pocket of creatures or a creature that, you know, was unique, had white hair, and was seen in you know, a number of places.
It's kind of like areas that have white squirrels. You know, I mean, there'll be like a number of generations of these squirrels that are white, or sometimes, you know, piebald. And then they'll just kind of like, you know, the generations will die out, and maybe that, you know, that gene will crop up again, you know, close by. So, but Seth, I wanted to ask you now, of the films that you have done currently, and you know, maybe even, you know, if you've gotten as far yet as to be talking to people with your Mothman film, what's the most impressive story, at least to you? What has impressed you the most from one of the witnesses or a number of the witnesses?
I think, honestly, in making the movies, I think my favorite account was actually told to me during the making of Minerva Monster by a lady who's not even in the movie. And it was the sister of one of the people that lived in the house that was being visited by the creature. And, you know, the way she recounted the story and the emotion that she still has about, you know, the sightings. And then also, there was a really unique aspect to her story that wasn't there with the rest of the family. She was absolutely convinced that the Minerva Monster was coming around their house because of her mother, some sort of kinship this creature felt to her mother. And her mother was sick at the time, and it ended up passing away. And after the mother passed away, this lady insisted that the Minerva Monster disappeared entirely, which is interesting as well, because the rest of the family is insistent that they're still there. But I think, I'm in love with the Minerva story just because I've been so kind of entrenched in it for so long. But I think that, you know, that story will always kind of stand apart from the rest of the stories we get to cover. Possibly because I don't know that we'll ever get to investigate a story that was pretty much just one family, something happening to one family. But yeah, that's probably my absolute favorite story. Although I have to say, the Mothman movie, the reason I wanted to make a documentary about the Mothman, and we shot it, we're actually already editing it, and it comes out this June. So, but the kind of accounts of what happened on the Silver Bridge were extremely emotional, to the point where when I was editing that sequence of the movie, I actually woke up one day and just wanted to edit that sequence of the movie. And I was completely drained by the end of the day, just kind of going over footage of the Silver Bridge collapse. And we have some unreleased footage that was shot the day after the bridge collapsed, so that we're going to be able to include in our movie. And to be sitting there and looking at that and the tragedy of that whole incident was extremely powerful. I mean, I don't know that I've ever had that experience while working on one of our movies.
Were you able to actually talk to people who were on the bridge at the time and survived?
We didn't, but we spoke to a lot of people in the town that remember when it happened that were there that night. One guy was a young boy, and him and his dad actually went down to the bridge and watched them pulling cars from the river and everything that night. And then, of course, we had this footage that was actually shot by a volunteer fireman who was on the river the very next day, helping to pull these cars out. And things like that. So we definitely were able to get that kind of emotion that I've never been able to really delve into a story that had a tragedy like that at its heart. So that was extremely powerful.
Mm-hmm. Now, You made, you know, you talked a little bit about this, you know, when you talked about the Minerva monster, and Lyle, after Seth, you can answer this too if you'd like. Do you think that some people actually, you know, may attract, you know, these creatures to them? Because there seems to be some cases where there are, you know, like repeated sightings by the same person. I mean, do you think there's, I don't know, maybe they smell good or something? Do you think that's a possibility?
I think if they're a curious kind of animal, which I do think they're very curious if they exist. if they're curious like that, maybe they do become fascinated by one particular individual. I would definitely think that might be the case with female, you know, with a woman. The motherly kind of aspect of women might attract an ape or something like that, like it does in nature. I could see it happening. In the case of the Minerva monster, that one of the reasons they think that the creature was coming down to the house was because the family was throwing scraps, food scraps, into a pit behind their house, and they actually saw this thing coming down and eating out of the pit. So that was what kind of initially drew it to the house. But they do think that once it was there, it became kind of enamored with the mom. So I do think that's a possibility. Yeah.
What about you, Lyle?
Yeah, it seems that could be the case, because you do, you know, have occasions where people have had multiple sightings, or, you know, when all things are equal, somebody will encounter something that somebody else didn't. So it could be very well be possible that, there are attracted to certain people for some reason, or some people just have a little more perceptive eye and have their eye open at the right time and sort of have an affinity for that sort of thing, because, you know, you can't dismiss all these accounts out of hand. Something's going on, and it's hard to say why some people have a lucky sighting and some don't, or why the creature would return to one place over and over and over. I think that could be the case.
Well, you know, that's one of the other aspects, you know, about this, is because, when I was a kid, most of the reported sightings were taking place, you know, like out in the Pacific Northwest. And then, you know, as I started reading more into it, I realized, as probably a lot of other people, that these sightings are practically everywhere. Do you think that we have, and it's not just in the United States as well, practically every country, I think in every place, with exception of maybe Hawaii, you know, has some kind of bipedal cryptid running around? I mean, do you think we are talking about a worldwide phenomena that there are, you know, maybe thousands of these things, you know, running around in the rivers and woods all across the planet?
Well, apparently so, because, yeah, the more you research, the more you dig into it, you can find at least one account from just anywhere. And it, for me, it's almost a problem, because it's like, wow, that just, you know, it just seems like they're in so many places that it would up the probability that one of them would make a mistake and walk in front of an oncoming car. But, on the other hand, you know, the places where they are reported are the kind of places where these creatures could, remain hidden or elusive. I mean, all these accounts in Arkansas, Oklahoma, and East Texas, and the places where I've, you know, gone myself. And, man, it, you know, you could stand 10 feet away in the summer in Arkansas. The foliage is so thick. I mean, something could be standing there 10 feet away and you would never see it. I mean, you can walk right past it. I mean, you know, and so, you know, it is conceivable that if these things are, you know, a certain intelligence, highly intelligent, have the wherewithal to sort of be elusive, they could certainly do it if they wanted to. And
now, how tall are the tallest of these creatures?
Well, I mean, I've 10, 7 to 8 foot, or where I you know, 8 foot, I guess, would be the top of the range of the southern Sasquatch. But I mean, I've seen occasionally reports from areas, other areas where they're 10 feet tall. I mean, I find that harder to believe. But, you know, really, I mean, people, when you see something in the distance, you can estimate what it was, but it's not an accurate science. I mean, people see it briefly. This isn't, you know, you're not out there with a tape measure, you know.
What do you think of the Peterson film?
Patterson film. Well, I mean, it's quite intriguing, and you know, I always thought that to me it looked like a real animal, and later on, now, you know, I mean, I've become friends with Bob Gimlin and have heard his side of the story in many, many other ways, and I can tell you that, in my estimation, that the man doesn't seem to be making this up. He's not, doesn't seem to be lying. You know, it's whatever was there, you know, either was a real thing or somehow he was fooled. You will never be able to answer that question because there's just not enough data in that film. But to me, I can see why they're skeptics, but, you know, it still does look like something non-human, and it also can't be replicated. They're like, everybody's like, oh, we can, you know, Philip Morris said, I made the suit, I can redo it. Nonsense. I've seen his remake, and it is dead instant, obviously, a person. So nobody can redo it, and that kind of helps it stand up over time.
Yeah, I have never seen a remake of that film that is even comes close to matching the strides that she was making in that riverbed.
Most of the other Bigfoot footage is rather suspect, to say the least. I mean, talk about the shaggy dog. you know, I mean, they just I don't know, but you know, it's like UFOs. So people say, oh, look at all the photos on, you know, YouTube or wherever, and you can't go by that, because some of the photos that are supposedly authentic, I know for a fact are not. They were not done. They were not created as fakes. But there's a lot of times that you can just get an image, and the even though you might not hallucinate, sometimes the camera can see things and twist it around a bit. Now, maybe not so much in the case of a large ape type creature, but certainly in the case of a UFO. But even with an ape like creature, I mean, how do we know who that is over there in the woods unless he stops to chat, perhaps? And speaking of chatting, I think, Tim, we've almost reached the midnight hour.
That's right.
And the party is still going on. I can hear the clinking of glasses, the moaning of monsters. And I want to give the opportunity for our guests to give us information, our listeners information, on where they can be reached. And we've got 2 minutes. So, Seth, you go first. Your movies, where can people view them?
Smalltownmonsters.com has all the info on our stuff, but they're available on Amazon and Vimeo on demand and on DVD at shop.smalltownmonsters.
I believe I saw the Whitehall Monster on Amazon.
Recently. It was Minerva is actually free through Prime right now.
Yeah, that's what I saw then. Yeah. And Lyle, beyond Boggy Creek, what else do you have in store for us?
Well, you can find my books in all your favorite places, such as Amazon, BarnesandNoble.com. They come in all the flavors, Kindle, Nook, paperback, and even some in hardback. You can find out more information on me at Lyle Blackburn, LYLEBlackburn.com. And, of course, that's got links to all the books I've written and information about the movies and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah, and, of course, the KCOR radio.com site. If they go to Exploring the Bizarre, they will find links to your sites and the Facebook pages and I don't know, any way of contacting you. I think it's all listed, thanks to our great producer Tina, who keeps the ball rolling every week. And I know Tim and I have been busy as we possibly can be. We're working on a new issue, a print edition of the Conspiracy Journal. And, of course, you can sign up online for our free weekly edition at conspiracyjournal.com. And good night, everybody. Good night, Sasquatch. Good night, Yeti. Good night, Elma. And good night, all our fabulous listeners.
You've been listening to Exploring the Bizarre with hosts Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz. They're taking back the night by jetting non-stop across the cosmos in search of the truly bizarre and totally unexplained, with you as their co-pilot. Thursday nights at 7 p.m. Pacific, 10 p.m. Eastern, on the KCOR Digital Radio Network. For more information on Exploring the Bizarre and hosts Timothy Beckley and Tim Swartz, check out their KCOR Digital Radio Network page. Follow their YouTube channel at MRUFO1100. Exploring the Bizarre.